So it's a book on feminism, raising feminist sons. You'll find one person say, I don't like being called a feminist. And she probably doesn't know what she means when she says that.
Hi everybody, welcome to Bookish. Today we have Shaili Chopra with us and we are going to talk about her journey, her books, what she has written, what she's going to write, and a wealth of experience that she's collected through her journey so far. So starting off, Shaili, tell me a bit about, you know, who you are and, you know, where did you start your amazing journey from?
Well, my journey actually started, I would say, as a journalist. Something that I wanted to be when I was in class 5. I used to stand up on a very tall podium and read the news out to the entire assembly with a printout that those days used to be dot matrix. And really had to strain hard to read what had gotten printed on that light print. But it was fantastic to just, be a news reader at that point as somebody who was misty-eyed about everything I saw on television. And then from then on, I sort of built on that fascination and said, no, I want to be a news reader. I want to be a news reader. I have to find all ways to do that. And I just stumbled upon my, college life and said that, okay, I think I want to do business. And as I do that, I realized that there was very, very little talent in the business reporting side. And so I thought it was a perfect match of my dreams and my training. So I put economics to use and became a journalist. And then, as luck would have it, I started presenting business news and went through the turmoil of Indian media with the starting of television to the tapering of it at some level with the onset of digital.
No, it's really exciting. So clearly you always enjoyed, being on stage and speaking, public speaking. What were the books that you sort of grew up reading and, that you really enjoyed as a child?
Actually, there were a lot of books that I read as a child. It took me a while to start reading. And somebody, actually was a librarian in one of the schools that I was in, she said, to read, you can't just start and imagine that you'll have a love for books. You have to toil through a bunch of them. And so I did. And by the time I hit my fourth book, I picked up, the entire Mallory Tarr's piece. And, so I was like, okay, that's interesting. Now, by the time I reach my fourth book, I actually think they're interesting. They're not like this task that I need to go through. Then happened Enid Blyton's and, the Famous Five and the whole lot of it. So it wasn't that early that I would have read, which we tend to do as parents and mothers. But by the time I got into reading, I was sort of hooked on to the new series of detective fiction that was coming out, and the Nancy Drews happened. And I think after that, fairly early in high school, I was taken in by reading Prodigal Daughter and, Cain and Abel. And so those books kind of were interesting because, again, they had this completely ambitious woman at the face of it who was fighting everything to become something, as the case was in Prodigal Daughter, for example. So it was interesting to read some of these in school, but really I think the love for books, to like have one every right next to me all the time, perhaps happened a little outside of the school world.
Wow, I think it's quite similar to my story, and you, I think, had an early feminist streak. I remember I got hooked to reading around grade 3, and before that I had read a few books, but I you have to really enjoy what you're reading, and I hadn't gotten to that point where I had gotten hooked to the books and the pages and the smell of books and all of that. And it was the Enid Blyton that did it for me, and after that there was no looking back.
For me, being a person who changed 17 schools in 12 classes over probably 10 types of uniforms, who went from central schools to Air Force schools to private schools, it was just a fascinating journey. I could wake up in a new school, make new friends and start again, and that was life. I gave up the idea of going to one of India's best boarding schools because I wanted to opt for this sense of constant change. And I think that really shaped me as a person. it sort of surged my confidence levels. I learned a lot of new things from people, new ideas, new words. You know, they say that you read a few thousand words every week or whatever, just by way of conversations. So with all kinds of people, multicultural people, it was just an amazing exposure for me. And it shaped me to the extent of, one, it made me tolerant of change. I mean, you know, today we're in a world where we've gone through cycles of media, which is the sector that I'm in. You know, when I was growing up, we couldn't believe that there was the cable TV. And just seeing that the elections were so hell-bent on using social media in 2014, I thought that story had to be told. And which is why when I wrote my first book, The Big Connect, Politics in the World of Social Media, it just came out in a matter of weeks. The whole book was done, I think, in a matter of weeks, because there was so much information. You know, what timelines on Facebook are doing, what Twiplomacy is, and all of that put together, really, I thought, was a winning story. And watching Narendra Modi and his election, reflecting back on the 2008 election of Obama, and then the re-election, and how he was using the tools, or how some of the other opposition parties were using the tools to negate or question and fact-check, I think that made for a fascinating book for me. So I kind of enjoyed that, because it was something I was in the thick of.
No, I think you got it very early on. I think a lot of us, you know, are very new entrants to social media, and people still struggle. But I do agree, you saw the potential very early on, and I think that has reflected in your work that you're doing even now. So was there any challenge you faced? You had two children, and they're, you know, they're little, I think one's just a baby, not even a year old.
Yeah.
And you've just, you know, I've seen you working right, you know, till the last day, and, you know, just continuing with. So where do you get that inner strength and inspiration from?
You know, I always have felt, and I don't know, it's about my upbringing and the way sort of my parents shaped my independent viewpoints, as well as having this absolutely amazing support system. So at the outside, I feel that I'm a bit privileged, but I speak to so many women on a daily basis. And, you know, we've covered, 50,000 stories of women through our stories and through events. Every woman tells us that she finds it so hard to stand on her own feet until somebody around her keeps validating it. And tragically for us, our society has had such a huge patriarchal overhang. I think in India it's very, very deep-rooted, but it doesn't seem very different in the United States, honestly. It seems to be everywhere. Women have great capability of taking and absorbing risk. They take a chance on themselves. But unfortunately, the construct around them is far more than just an eggshell. It's hard to break. It's hard to get out. It's hard to go out there and tell your journey and say, this is how I'd like to do. I think practically every woman in the country today has an ambition. That ambition could be however big, however small, but she has a goal and she wants to meet it. I think today we really need to create better environment to say having maternity, mobility issues is not a sort of sword on your neck. It's okay, it's part of life, right? People don't even question it. Exactly. So when we set up She the People, people would ask me, why do women need a separate space? And I said, you know what? When we go to general spaces, they just seem to be full of men. And men don't seem to be ever told that why is this general space full of men? So, you know, you always wonder that the questions are always asked when you do a Women Writers Fest, you do a Digital Women Awards, and they're like, why is this such vehement focus on women? Because they need a voice. I've met two amazing women. One is using Facebook and the other is using Google to transform their lives. You know, the lady from Facebook, she actually works, who uses Facebook, she connects with farmers in Maharashtra. And she says people actually log on to Facebook and say, oh, this is the didi who will give me business because I can sell the production of Rajgira to her and then she will connect me to the market. This other lady is a beekeeper in Maharashtra, Satara district, and she used WhatsApp and Google to understand how bee diseases can be sorted by just logging onto the internet. When you hear these stories, you're like, what business does any global magazine or Indian magazine have to put all those fancy women who are being put there for their designations? And I think these are the women who need that. the spotlight.
So tell us a bit about, you know, your new book that, you know, you signed up and you're writing for us, and the themes of which are very close to my heart, but I want you to share with all our viewers today about, you know, what it is.
So it's a book on feminism, tentatively called Feminist Rani. It's an idea that started out when She the People was born. For me, feminism as an idea is not a definition in a book. It's forever evolving. It's about how different women perceive what is feminism to them and how they put up a little fight on big issues and small issues every single day. These go from people who are celebrities to an everyday woman and how she deals with what she deals with. And that's why when we sort of kicked off, you know, this series of programs, the idea was to have contemporary conversations about feminism, whether it was about feminist mothers, raising feminist sons, having conversations at home on the dining table, making feminism palatable on the plate, and not sort of being about necessarily somebody who has a lati and is only going to raise a voice that is saying it's me or nothing, woman or no one. I think the idea was to say it has to be an inclusive process. And that's why I think then it's a fascinating subject, because we have an opportunity to rewrite history. And as we do that, it is really truly an opportunity to say that this is how Indian women are changing. And they're changing because they are becoming out, you know, sort of coming out of their own. They are talking the language that they believe in. They are looking up to icons. They're looking up to themselves. They're looking up to neighbors and saying, if she can do it, I want to try too. And I think that itself is really the backbone of feminism. It happens to be coming out in interesting times because there is so much debate about whether I like to be a feminist or not. You know, so many people in the film industry, I just talk about them because they sometimes come out as the top headlines. You'll find one person say, I don't like being called a feminist. And she probably doesn't know what she means when she says that. And it would be true for somebody else who'll take the other extreme. I am a feminist, but she doesn't know what she stands for. So I thought it would be really nice to bring about this perspective from a lot of women who have broken the glass ceiling in a way that nobody else has, you know, whether it's a female comic, men who are feminists. Yes, that's a real thing. Men do stand up for women.
Exactly, and we need
many more. Yes, and we need men who not just stand up for women, but actually point out to men that what they're doing is inappropriate. So, you know, I think that way, feminism has suddenly got very, very wide arms and it can embrace a lot.
You now interviewed so many women for the book, and you know, I don't want to divulge the names yet, it's a little early. But is there any connection that you saw, any quality or a set of qualities that you feel were sort of common between these women?
You know, what is common is their very, very diverse struggle. And I think that's what makes this book very, sort of very rich with thought, with passion, with fights. And you know, and every time I think about each of these women who we've interviewed, you know, there's that comment that, look, I did it because I had no other way. You know, I mean, people are pushed to the corner and they yet don't break down when it comes to their principles. And those who break down go looking for help. So I think one of the things that really fascinates me about feminism, and that's coming through in this book, feminism is not about doing it alone. It's not about being alone. You talk about soft power. Today, the world is moving to everything being done by formulas and algorithms. The only thing in the unknown is creativity, soft power, something that women are born with, right? Like multitude of emotions, to be able to see things from different lenses. The other thing you talked about was support systems. You know, you can be a complete feminist if you are going out there and seeking a support system to work for you. It's not like you are, you know, losing your own... Exactly, you're not losing your personality. You're just being smart about what you need. And irrespective of what your end goal is, I think feminism that way has been pretty badly battered as a definition in our lives. In its own history, it was driven by movements. But I believe that the idea of rebel is very much today a part of a larger ecosystem that says, let's not just compete, let's collaborate for the greater good of women, rather than say, that's your way and this is my way.
Exactly. Like, you know, and to your point, it is inclusive.
Yes.
You know, it has to be done together so that there is this whole large wave of transformation, and it affects many more women across different segments and sectors and states and diversities in the country. So I think there's a lot to be done, you know, and it's evolving, ever evolving. But I think books definitely are a very special way of touching lives. You know, books have changed my life, and I'm sure so many other lives around. And one of the things that we very passionately feel about at Penguin Random House India is to, you know, grow readership and how to encourage reading.
Yeah.
So I hope through the book, you know, many more women read the book, understand, you know, it's not feminist, views are not very drastic. You can have your own definition given your circumstances and mold it to, you know, become the best that you can in your environment. Any message that, you know, you'd like to give to the viewers today and readers about books, reading, or anything that you feel to tell viewers from your heart before we close today?
I have just been fascinated with what books have done to me. We, as you know, at She the People run the Women Writers Fest series, now in 6 cities. I'm a passionate believer in that women are writing some great stuff. They're writing experiences in business, they're writing self-help. There is nothing wrong in having self-help books by your bedside. If they help you, that works. Okay, I think there's a stigma often attached with, oh, she's reading a self-help book. Well, she needs help. And it's perfectly fine, right? So I think, like, you know, for me, a great novel is a great novel, and I would probably read one, but I just love books that tell me about real people, because there's so much to read. In college, I read a great deal of Chomsky and what was happening around us, and, you know, there was an opportunity to meet him. So yes, there was a part of me, I think, like, it should be in everybody's lives. You should have, like, a complete left exposure and a complete right exposure, even when you're reading.
And then find your own self.
Yeah, hopefully. Though these days you shouldn't guess. But so for me, books are more real than unreal. And the real people around us have so many real challenges. And that makes books so much.
No, very interestingly put. I think it is, you know, very personal. People like to read different kinds of books. And what I tell all viewers is that read whatever you can find. Books, magazines, newspapers,
yes.
What you can read digitally. Just read. It doesn't matter whether you like fiction, non-fiction, biographies, music, art, thrillers. We have it all at Penguin Random House. You can always come to us for on our website for recommendations and new books that we're publishing all the time.
And although I would add, though, for me, one thing that's changed,
yeah.
a lot different from a lot of people I know, I love digital books. It's nice to have shelves full of
them. It's just another way of reading books.
Yeah.
So I say no matter what, wherever you can, in what way you can, read on your phone, devices. But it's really important to keep on reading, spread the message how important books are. They've changed our lives clearly, and I'm sure they'll change your lives too. Thank you so much, Shaili, for joining
Thanks,
us today
Lily.
On Bookish. It's been a pleasure having this wonderful conversation with you today and learning so much more about, you know, you and your work. I hope you continue to do the fascinating work that you're doing, and I wish you all the best in the future. We will publish a book very soon, and I can't wait to get to that point.
That's right.
Thank
That's
you so
thanks
much.
Thanks so much.
And it's been wonderful having you here.
Lovely. Thanks so much.